My name is Hubert. I'm from Austria, to make it short. I'm a freelancer. The good point about this is there's nothing I want to sell to you. First question, does anybody know what this thing on the slides is? It's the platform for building electronic vehicles, which you may know by name. And it's a hint for the talk, because we are talking about the platform. Before I start, I want to give you a short introduction about myself. Code Witness by me is in the following products, and with this I do not mean only business feature code, also a lot of infrastructure code. So I was working for a company which did products for this kind of people, so hospital information systems. I did a lot of Java, this was 9 years. Then I switched to this company, which makes disk machines, where you can grab your packages 24/7. In this company, I was working for this company, I read Jess Humbles and Dave Farley's awesome book about continuous delivery, which switched my mind, and I also switched my focus towards the DevOps topics. And in this company, I failed to establish a DevOps mindset, to be honest. Then I switched to this company, which makes stuff for Google AdWords. I didn't switch to Google. I switched to a company which is doing stuff with Google AdWords. I was the DevOps guy. Now I'm the infrastructure architect. We switched from Monolith towards microservices running on Kubernetes. We had some bad experiences with Docker Swarm, but the Kubernetes thing worked out very well. And I also did a lot of stuff with CI/CD. What did I learn in these years? Yeah, you can skip this. I'm even that old that I have a SAN certificate. I do not know if that's a good reputation, but I have an Oracle cover certificate and some Spring. I did my Kubernetes application developer a few months ago. I do not think that certifications mean a thing, but I wanted to give you some info. Who am I? I know of people which are way smarter than me without any certifications. Nowadays, I care more about the cloud native stack, for example, and Docker and Kubernetes and Prometheus and stuff like this. Years ago, I did this kind of stuff, and the funny thing is, I was also some kind of the DevOps guy in this band. I started as a guitarist, as nearly everybody. But due to the fact there are less bass players, I started to play bass. I'm also capable of playing drums, so also I did the drums in some bands. And in the end, I even did the background vocals, which was maybe not the best decision of my life, to be honest. Nowadays, I care more about my family. And this photo was taken from our last summer vacancy where we took our bikes with us. And for sure, there had to be some Kubernetes greatness also in my vacancy. Let's talk about Knative. Today, in the morning, I read on Twitter that Knative 0.6 is released. So it's still some kind of bleeding edge, which will make my live demos a little bit more scarier for me. But we will work that out, I hope. I think it has the potential to get a game changer. So, although it's early in the morning, we can do the hand-up game here. Who has worked with Kubernetes already yet? A few hands. Who has it in production? Who runs it in production? Great. Who has worked with Knative? That's great. So most of you will know this curve. That's the hype curve. On the x-axis, you have the time. On the y-axis, you have the visibility. And a few weeks ago, somebody said to me, Knative is hype shit. And maybe he's right about this. But that's not negative. Each great technology has started as hype at some point in time. The problem is people expect too much of a technology sometimes. So if a technology gets born, maybe some companies are successful with that technology, and other companies, which also want to get successful, have wrong expectations. And so we end in the trough of disillusionment, and the end in the plateau of productivity. So some kind of thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. Yeah, I think Kinetisch is at the beginning of its journey. So what is Kinetisch? So Kinetisch is a Kubernetes-based platform to build, deploy, and manage modern serverless workloads. The key parts are here Kubernetes-based and serverless. I will talk about Kubernetes in a few slides. First, we will talk about serverless. On this slide, you see some rings, and the smaller the ring, the better. The smaller the ring, the more the developer can perform. Meaning, if a developer has to care about hardware, meaning buying machines, putting operating systems on it, putting even disk drives in it, it takes time. If you're talking about infrastructure as a service, the developer has to care about, for example, Ansible scripts, Chef cookbooks, and other infrastructure as code tools, for example. Container as a service, yeah. The developer has to care about Docker files, about creating Docker images and pulling them to a registry. If you're talking about platform as a service, if you're talking about Java, the developer has to care about putting some Java into some application server. And the smallest circle is function as a service, where the developer really can concentrate on coding. That's also the reason why it's very liked by managers, because at least in Austria, we have a resource problem with developers. There are simply too less developers. So you can pay more, for example, or you can try to make your developers more productive. And that's the big selling point of serverless, I think. On this cartoon, you see some icebergs. So on the, this is a tries to give you an image about the costs of running a serverless product or a traditional product. So on the left, you have the serverless costs, which are a little bit bigger than the server costs. But below the surface, a lot of hidden costs are. If you run your own servers or if you do infrastructure as a code, you have more engineering hours because somebody has to roll out Ansible scripts, for example, to make a machine usable. You have also slow innovation because, yeah, you have to roll out the Ansible scripts. You have a higher total cost of ownership because you own a lot of stuff. You probably own machines or you own the infrastructure as code. And technically debt, to be honest, in the projects I was working, the quality level of infrastructure was as long as it works. And I'm interested in your responses now. Who of you does infrastructure as code in your companies? So Chef, Puppet, Salt. Do you test your code, your infrastructure as code? Okay. I'm basically in the same situation. It's a great discussion we have in my company nowadays. Code is great, but code should be tested. So. Yeah, and for sure you have to do infrastructure maintenance and security, meaning doing security patches, updating Docker, for example, stuff like that. So you don't have to read everything on this slide. That's a serverless product, in this case from Google, but that's true for all other public cloud vendors. So you see some Go code below, which runs on the runtime 1.11 and gets triggered by HTTP request, and the response will also be via HTTP. I have some issues with that. The first issue I have, I'm bound to the public cloud vendor. So if I would like to migrate from Google to AWS, for example, it's not that easy. And vendor lock-in is a big issue in the serverless stack. For example, if you want to do edge computing in China, as far as I know, there are no data centers in China from AWS. So you can't do that simple nowadays. You should have some way to migrate to another cloud vendor. The second issue I have, you are limited to the runtimes. As I did the screenshot, I Go 1.12 was already released, but there was no way to use that in this public cloud vendor because it was simply not offered. This problem even goes further. If we are talking about doing PDFs with, for example, Jasper reports, as far as I know, Jasper reports expect some fonts on operating system level. No way to do that here. And this text box, I can only speak for myself. I'm not a big fan of coding in a text box. Think of testing, think of refactoring, think of debugging. I'm not sure about this. So Kubernetes and Knative to the rescue. What if we run our serverless stack on top of a Kubernetes cluster? So no matter where the Kubernetes cluster is running, on-premise or within a cloud provider managed, we can run our stack. If so, we can run whatever we want as long as we can put it into a container, meaning if you would like to do Fortran, as long as you can put your Fortran stack into a container, that's fine. Yeah, and we should simply use an IDE. Currently, some big players doing stuff with Knative. Google announced 2 months ago on Google Next Google Cloud Run, which is based on Knative. It's already usable yet. IBM is migrating cloud functions, they're already existing functions as a service product, towards IBM Cloud Kubernetes Service. Same for Pivotal, they have a product already, which is called Riff, and they're migrating towards Pivotal Function Service, which is also based on Knative. Red Hat is baking Knative into OpenShift. SAP has a Knative-based product, which is called Kyma. And also AWS is on board, which is, in my opinion, a big deal. I was not sure at the beginning of this year if AWS will support this, because they have a very successful serverless product. But I think 2 months ago, they announced that Trigger Mesh is also doing stuff with Knative. Here you can see, you can't really see it, to be honest. Here you can see who contributes the most to Knative. Yeah. That's not good. You can see the biggest contributor is Google. Red Hat is the follower, and Pivotal IBM. So really huge players are currently contributing to Knative. Okay. So I will leave the slide for a second. Is it a toilet? Is it a grill? Is it a fridge? You master a tool when you know when not to use it. That's the point of the last slide. Knative is not a function as a service product. Knative is a platform to build function as a service product. And that brings me back to my first slide. It's a platform. What do I mean with that? I'm not that sure if each and every startup on this earth now should start with playing around with Knative. There are big players which are currently creating Knative-based products which are usable afterwards. In the live demos, you will see it. I will do a lot of stuff with YAML and Kubernetes. So I'm not sure if that's the idea behind Knative, that each and every company now should create their own Knative stack. So now we come to the technical part. Knative has 3 building blocks. So to run Knative, you have to have some Kubernetes cluster. And also Istio installed. Istio is needed for routing. Since a few months, you can also use Clue instead of Istio. And the dependency from Knative to Istio was, in my opinion, a pragmatic decision because they needed something for routing. And Istio was there. If this dependency exists in the future, we will see. The first building block is build. So build cares about creation of container images, meaning you have some source code and you want to create a container image out of it. The second building block is serving. It's about scale to zero and request-driven compute. And that's the important part, scale to zero. The zero is important. If you have no load on your application, Knative will scale down the application to zero, meaning there are no costs. If you have a lot of requests to your application, Knative will scale up. And the last building block is eventing. So it's about event binding and delivery. Think of GitOps. For example, you have a GitHub repository and you do a commit. Something has to trigger a build. And for these questions, the building block eventing was made basically to have some eventing infrastructure. Before I will talk about the three building blocks, I want to give some intro to Kubernetes. This was basically some kind of a infrastructure in the good old times, years ago, very simplified. On the left, you have a developer machine. On the right, you have the users of your application. And in the middle, you have some machine which is serving your application. And the task of the developer was to get his application onto the server, basically. So now we are talking about Kubernetes. So the developer machine and the users have stayed the same. Now we have a Kubernetes cluster. Kubernetes consists of master nodes and nodes, previously known as minions. For sure, you should have more than one master node, and you will have more than one node. But for the sake of simplicity, we leave it like this. Kubernetes has state, and the only place where Kubernetes has state is etcd, meaning if you apply some YAML, in the end, this information gets stored in the key value store, which is etcd. And for sure, you should have a highly available etcd infrastructure. The only component talking to etcd is the API server. And if you do a kubectl apply, for example, you're talking to the API server. The API server will authorize your request, will do some validation, and will also do some enhancements because you do not want to fill each and every YAML property. On the nodes, we have some container engine, for example, Docker. And there's a thing which is called kubelet. Kubelet is talking to the container engine, to the local container engine, and also is talking to the API server, which means, so the kubelet gets information what should run on that machine and will start it in the container engine. And also the kubelet gives information back to the API server if something goes wrong so that the Kubernetes can start the application on a different machine, for example. There's a controller manager. If you're talking about Kubernetes, we are talking about resources and resource types. A resource type is, for example, pod, or deployment, or service, or daemon set. And the controller manager takes care about the controllers. There's a pod controller, there's a service controller, there's a daemon set controller. And the scheduler makes the decisions where to run what, taking your resource limits and resource requests into concern. And the last component here is the kube proxy. The kube proxy takes care about networking. We are, for example, manipulating IP tables on the machines. So now we create our first deployment. Kubernetes will then start a pod with a container which runs our application. Now the application is reachable from within the cluster, but not from the outside world. So let's change this. We apply a service. In the simplest case, we use a service of type NodePort, which means this application is reachable for on each and every node with a high port number, which doesn't make us that happy, because think of TLS termination and some advanced routing. So we create an ingress. Now we can do TLS termination. And we put a load balancer, for example, up front, which is not managed by Kubernetes. These things are managed by a public cloud provider. Yeah. So what is Istio? Istio, we will inject an additional container into your pods containing the Envoy proxy, some kind of reverse proxy, which will take all the traffic. On the control plane, there's Pilot, which is about service discovery and also about doing canary releases, and also resiliency, meaning you can configure timeouts, retries, circuit breakers. Mixer is about access control and collects data from the Envoy proxies. And the last thing is Citadel, which is about credential management. Let's talk about the first building block, which is serving. The first building block would be built, but it makes more sense to talk about serving up front. On installing Knative, which is just applying a bunch of YAML files to your existing Kubernetes cluster, a lot of stuff gets installed. Also some custom resource definitions, which are the API for Kubernetes, some kind of API. And the first custom resource definition which gets installed for the serving building block is service. And that's a very ugly name clash with the Kubernetes service. So a Kubernetes service is not the same as a Knative service. You have to say kubectl get ksvc or kubectl get kservice. Yeah. This was also a big discussion in the community. On the creation of a service, an Istio route will get created, and a configuration. The configuration is a mutable object. It's a mutable object, and each mutation will create a revision, which is an immutable object, holding the user's code, meaning the container image, and the container's configuration. So let's do the same with some colored boxes. So we create this Knative service in our cluster, which will create the route and a configuration. Each mutation of the configuration will create the revision. And afterwards, the traffic can be routed to the revision. If we do a mutation of the configuration, is that readable, by the way? Tool? Kind of small, okay. Each mutation of the configuration will create a new revision, and the route will be rerouted to the newer revision. You can do some advanced traffic routing. For example, you can do 90% of the traffic going to revision A and 10% going to revision B, for example. This was on deploying that stuff. Now we are talking about the runtime, meaning we have our Knative service already running in our application. So there's the Istio route in place. The first request comes in. Due to the fact that the revision is not activated at this point in time, the Istio will route the first request to the activator. The activator will activate the revision, which will create a deployment and will create pods, or one pod. This takes some time until the pod is up and running and ready. So there is some latency involved, but that's the same for all serverless products. We have some latency. Afterwards, the response gets sent back. On doing the second request, Istio will send the request directly to the pod, which is already running. The pod sends some metric data to the autoscaler. The autoscaler will do decisions concerning scaling up and down the pods, the number of pods. And we can configure this. We will do this afterwards. Yeah, the autoscaler scales up and down stuff. So this is the simplest Knative service which you can deploy on your Kubernetes cluster. The only thing we have done here is basically defining the container image. So which brings us to the live demo. Let's do this. But up front, I want to show you the application, basically, which is a Spring Boot Kotlin application which takes some environment variable and puts it out, basically. Due to the fact we are afterwards talking about the building block, I want to do the building manually now. So we have to build that stuff. The tests are disabled, so this should not take that long. Okay, it's all in. Then we have to do the Docker build. Oh, sorry about that. So starting the Docker VM will take a few seconds, so I can drink. In the meantime, I can show you some other stuff. So if you're working with Kubernetes already and you have to work with different Kubernetes clusters, I have some hint for you. Use this one. Use kube context. It's very usable. You can switch between Kubernetes clusters in a very convenient way. And also use Kubernetes. You can switch between namespaces in a very convenient way. So it makes life much more easy. So it's up and running, yeah. Okay, I'm all right. So we are building our Docker image and we are pushing it to my Docker Hub repo. While doing this, I will switch to another. It's really hard to see. Is the console readable for you? Or is it okay? There is another command line tool which is called Knative Control, CN Control, which makes life much easier on doing Knative stuff. And the YAML I've shown you on the slides, you can also do with a one-liner. It's exactly this one. So we are deploying the service with a one-liner. This again will take a few seconds. We get some logging from the application, from the pod, which is running. Then we wait for 5 seconds, and hopefully this didn't work out all the time, to be honest. This works out. Where's my mouse? Here. So now we are saying kubectl get ksvc. So the application seems to run. And where's my mouse? Ah, here. And on clicking here. What's wrong here? Okay. It was hidden. Ah. Okay. Hello Knative, which means the application is running. I'll keep this like this. So back to the slides, and I have to make it like this, yeah. So this was our first Knative service applied to our Kubernetes cluster. Of course, you can do more advanced stuff. For example, here we configure the how Knative will do its decision concerning scaling up and down. So we are taking into concern, in this case, the CPU metric. Previously, it was the default, which is the concurrency. So we are here we are saying use the CPU metric if we have a load above 15% per core, scale up. And the minimum of pods running is 1, and the maximum of pods running is 5. The CPU metric at this point in time doesn't support scaling down to 0 yet. I think this will change. So let's do this. I'm in the right, yeah. Now we are applying the YAML file, as you have seen it. And in the meantime, I will... Here we will watch the pods in this case. And I think I should increase the size. Oh, I think I will do it like this. So you are seeing the first Knative service is already terminating because there's no load on it. And the second one is already running. So if you do a kubectl get ksvc, we can visit this in the browser again. By the way, KN Control has very good support for doing custom domain names and stuff like that. So for sure I had to do some preparations, and also the domain name stuff was prepared up front. Now we are trying to put some load on that Knative service. So let's do this like this. And hopefully this Knative service gets scaled up because we are doing a lot of requests. We can also take a look at this in the Google Kubernetes Engine UI. So we have the workloads here. And I think I have to refresh it. And somewhere the K service by CPU should be running, yeah. And we see the pods here, it's still one pod. With no CPU metric now, this has some latency, this will take some time. But now we are seeing there are two unhappy pods currently, so we also already should see them also here. So Knative did the scale up. Well. Let's stop this madness, if I can. Yeah. And delete that stuff. So, okay, I'm here. It's really hard to see. I'm here. Next building block, build. It's about creation of container images. So you have some source code and want to create a container image. The first custom resource definition is build template, which is about defining steps to get a container image. There's also the cluster build template, which is basically the same, but on cluster level, the build template operates on namespace context level. And they have to be builds. A build is simply a build. And there are already some build templates which exist, so you can use them like they are. The first one is Google Basel. It's based on Google Place. Google open sourced their polyglot build tool, basically. Google Chip is also from Google, is about building GVM-based stuff. So in the end, these are Cradle plugins or Maven plugins, which you can use. We will use them afterwards. Google Kaniko, we will also use afterwards. That's about building containers completely in user space, meaning you don't have to have the wormhole pattern or the privileged containers. Cloud Foundry Buildback is, as far as I know, from Pivotal. And the scary part of Buildback is that you don't have to give meta information which language you have written your code. Buildback will guess that for you. I'm not sure about this. Atomic Builder is about creation of OCI-compliant images. Mobi Build Kit is an advancement of the multi-stage builds. And Übermakiso is also about creation of containers without completely in user space. We will use Kaniko and Chip in the live demos. So this is a build. So it's not that complicated. You have to care about credentials for sure. You have to be able to get the source code from your, for example, GitHub repo. And you have to be able to push and pull containers, for example, to Docker Hub, which we will do in a few seconds. KN Control has great support for this too, to get the secrets and the credentials. You have to give the information where your source code is located, and you can define the revision, for example. And here we are using the Kaniko template, which only needs one argument, which is the name of the image we want to create. Kaniko expects a Docker file in the root folder of your Git repo, but you can customize this for sure. Yeah, let's do this. So I have some YAML files here, and we. Apply the build, sorry, Kaniko. The build template I already installed up front, I hope. Yeah. And you have seen a pod has been started, and we will do a third, make it bigger. And we watch the builds, which is also a custom resource definition in Knative build. And you see here, we are not succeeded yet. That's fine, because the pod is still building that stuff. By the way, I forgot this to mention. We are building a Go application now. And we also should see this here in the workloads. And refresh it again. Oh, it was already here. It's already succeeded. That's fine. So this was quite fast. You can see here some init containers. The first one cared about the credential stuff. The second one cared about getting the source code. And the third build step was basically building that stuff afterwards. So yeah, we can take a look at my repo, and this is again way too small. But here stands updated a few seconds ago, so this is our build has succeeded and pushed the container image to Docker Hub. So, but now we are doing something advanced. What about creation of a Knative service which know how to build itself? You can do that. So we combine a Knative service with the information how to build itself. So we are creating a Knative service which will create a route and a configuration, and the configuration knows how to build itself. And the build will grab that stuff, the source code from GitHub, create the container image, push it to Docker Hub, create the configuration that was a mutation of the configuration, so a revision will get created. The revision will grab the container from Docker Hub, and the route will take care that the traffic comes to the right revision. We even do it more advanced stuff. We are writing now our own build template. And writing a build template which fits to your needs of your organization is very easy. In this case, this build template has only one build step. You can have multiple build steps for sure. The build step will use a cloud builder for Gradle to create your jar file, basically. And basically, this comes down to Gradle test classes test chip. So chip is the Gradle plugin we are using. And we have some parameter. I will talk in a second. And you can define for sure the working tier. You can define parameters in your build template, which then have to be used in your builds. We will see on the next slide. Like this. Here we are giving the argument a value. And this yellow block is the knowledge how to build yourself, basically. So the build I've shown you before within a Knative service. And the revision template only has basically the container image and tag. Let's do this. So first we have to find the mouse. And we apply the build template I have shown you. Build template chip, yeah. And now we are using it. And again, hopefully, a pod gets started and a build gets started. It's currently in state, it's not succeeded yet. We can again take a look at the Google console. I think I have to refresh it. It's here. Now I'm talking about the Java Spring application, Spring Boot application again. And we can take a look at the logs, hopefully. You can optimize for sure for performance, meaning you can create Gradle caches, for example. Which I've not done yet, so this will take a few seconds because, yeah, it will download all the dependencies now. Okay, takes a few seconds. And by the way, I tricked the demo gods, if this works out, because that's the last demo for today. It's still, well, maybe I was too early with that sentence. Still working. Maybe we have some logging. No. 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 Yeah, I was too early. But now it says it succeeded. Yeah, the logging, it takes some seconds to get that in the centralized login system. But one last try. Yeah, it downloaded stuff and created the container image. And if you do, you see it's running, and if we click on it, it's also running in a browser. which brings me to Tecton. Some of you may think that's way too complicated, and where can I put in my whatever code to do serverless stuff? Knative is a platform to build function as a service products. So that's the key point, basically, of this talk. And even for build, these are way too less things, custom resource definition, for really doing production stuff. There's a new project which is called Tecton. Tecton is about build pipelines, retries, and other stuff for really creating CI/CD with Knative. Tecton is part of the Continuous Delivery Foundation. Also Jenkins 6 is part of. And I have spent a few months now with migrating from TeamCD to GitLab CI. And this really took months. And I really hope that that stuff brings some, doesn't makes this migration work pain less, more painless. Last building block is eventing. There are also some custom resource definitions, so sources. This is where the event gets born. So, for example, this can be a GitHub source. So, GitHub is sending something to your Kubernetes cluster. You have channels. You can have in-memory channels, or you can have persistent channels. For sure, in production, you should have persistent channels. And subscriptions. The easiest way of doing eventing with Knative is defining the service, the receiver of the events within the service. So, yeah, the service is responsible of delivering all events to the service. So if it's down, you maybe have an issue. In production, you should do something like this. You define a source which sends the events to the channel, which hopefully is persistent, meaning if the channel, for whatever reason, gets down, no events get lost. You can subscribe to a channel, and each subscriber of the channel will get all events. And that's basically it.